First of all, let me start by telling you the best parts about having cancer. When you are 11 years old and you're waiting in line for the FBI building and it's freezing cold outside and the line is 3 hours long and your mom walks up to the front and says, "Excuse me, my son has asthma and he's being treated for leukemia." They let you write it. you know, and then you get to hang out with guys like Paul Newman, Don Imus. You get to go to a ton of Giants games for free. And the morphine. The morphine's the best. I am a acute ALL survivor. I was diagnosed when I was 11 years old. And when I was 11 years old, I was like a crazy active kid. I mean, kind of the same now, except I'm a little taller. But I was a crazy kid full of energy all the time. And I wasn't myself. I was tired all the time. I had bruising petechiae all over my body. My lymph nodes in my neck on both sides were the size of the baseballs. And my mom took me to the pediatrician's office like 4 times. And every single time, it's kind of the same thing. Every single time, the pediatrician said, "No, he has a cold. He'll be okay. He'll get over it." And she kept taking me. And finally, we went back, and the pediatrician actually yelled at my mom and said, "Excuse me? No. I told you he has a cold. He'll be okay. But fine. Okay, go to the hospital, get a blood test, and you'll see." So we went to the hospital, and this is like motherly instinct, you know? Mothers are always right. I hate to admit it. So we went to the hospital, and we got a blood test. We had to wait a couple hours for the results. My mom knew something was happening. My hair was really long at the time, so she had me go get a haircut. They chopped it all off. I absolutely hated it. She took me to go get a board game. She said, "You get any board game you want, except for Dungeons and Dragons, because that's a bad influence." We walk back into the pediatrician's office, and it's dead silent. A nurse comes up to me, and she sits me down. She grabs me, and she sits me down. Another nurse comes up to my mom and walks down the hall. And the pediatrician walks out. A couple more nurses come out and surround my mom. And I couldn't hear them, but I could see them. And the this was one of the scariest moments of my life on the same day. The pediatrician comes out, and she starts talking. All of a sudden, my mom started crying. And then I started crying. And the nurse holding me started crying. It was a cry fest. I was 11. My mom was in no condition to drive, so one of the nurses knew my mother. She drove us to a pediatric oncology hospital. It was actually Overlook Hospital. I was treated at Overlook and then in Summit, New Jersey, one by the Valerie Center and then the Imus Center. So they drove us to Overlook Hospital, and we sat down. My dad met us there, and we sat down with a man named Stephen Halpert. And he's a pediatric oncologist, and he said, "Brett, you have cancer." The second scariest moment of my life. And all I knew at 11 years old was that cancer killed you. And I was like, "All right, well, that's it. I'm gonna die." And then 2 seconds later, he looks at me and says, "But there's treatment." And as soon as he said that, I was like, "All right, let's do it. I'm ready." 3 years, 2 months of treatment of chemotherapy. This is about half of the medication I took. So, yeah. I had 10 rounds of radiation in my brain. This is called a Russian helmet technique, where it's actually a mold of my face of when I was 11 years old. It's a little puffy because I was under steroids. They don't, you know, not the ones that build muscles, but the ones that make you fat. I got 10 rounds of radiation in my brain. I lost a lot of brain cells, so now I'm only a genius. I have a sister who's 2 years older than me. And well, obviously, you know, when your son is going through cancer, your parents are gonna spend most of their time with them. So my sister became an orphan. But the community rallied and like they took care of my sister. Honestly, I only got cancer because I'm selfish. I wanted their attention. The community rallied. They thought I was dying so much, they even gave me a make-a-wish. I got a make-a-wish. I got to go to Australia with my whole family. We went for 2 weeks. It was definitely worth faking the whole thing. to go to Paul Newman's camp, to Don Imus's camp. I always said that if I knew I was going to live, I would have gone through it, just because of all the amazing people that rallied and, you know, all the things that I got to do. And I mean, you know, it's, I am who I am because of it. So there, I'll show you some pictures. I was such a cute kid. What happened? Yeah, keep going. So this is obviously, you know, pre-cancer. This is my sister. So let me see. All right, pre-cancer. And this actually, when I was struck with cancer, I was in a theater company, and they actually rallied, and they made. They made a video, like they took one day at a rehearsal and they made a video, because I was actually diagnosed while I was in a play there, but they made a video and, like, you know, it was about, like, them, they're finally going to burn down the theater because I was a pyromaniac as a little kid and they thought it was cool and something they could do for me, and, like, everybody watched it in the hospital and it was, like, uplifting for everybody. So steroids. This is what steroids does to you. So, this is me on steroids, this is me at 11, and now, here, keep going, so the theater company, this is me, I'm in a play, what is the name of the play then? Something Like It Hot, and I was playing the lead gangster role. Everyone thought it was the best skullcap ever. And then now, I live in Los Angeles, and I light myself on fire for a living. So that's me in a nutshell. So thank you guys for having me here, and it's really great what you're doing, and what you do for, you know, for us. It's inspiring, so.